I met my husband at the Bayshore Park. It was the last Sunday in August in 1943. That Sunday, which I didn't want to go anyway, but my sister talked me into it, happened to be a group of men down there that I did some gymnastics with. We were just really showing off because everybody comes around and watches. It's like giving a show. And I kind of had him picked out for my sister because he was so tall and I'm so little. But it didn't work out that way. Sherry is my daughter, and she came to live with me after my husband died.
The best part about my moving back here was that my mother was able to maintain her independence, and she's very independent. She may be 91, but she's sharp as a tack and capable of doing just about anything I can do except drive and things that take really good eyesight.
Ideally, in the perfect world, as people lived longer, they'd also live healthier. And so instead of being sick for 16 years and being kept alive by a bunch of medicines and interventions, people would be living longer and being healthier.
The need to take care of an older population in a more efficient way, in a way that brings greater value to care, is very important for the entire society because we can't afford to do otherwise.
We've reached a point now where many of the answers to the contemporary problems of American healthcare are the very problems that geriatricians have been working on for the last three decades. From the seeds that Mason F. Lord planted, the fruit has grown principally on a unique campus, which has been the Johns Hopkins Bayview Medical Center, which not only houses the majority of the faculty in the Division of Geriatric Medicine, but has aging expertise in surgery, orthopedic surgery, in oncology, in psychiatry, in anesthesiology. And we are also the home of the National Institute of Aging on this very campus. So in many respects, it's the Silicon Valley of aging care and research right here.
Where else can you be where you can be with a patient safety institute and collaborating with the Center on Aging and working with the School of Public Health, all three trying to work together to find solutions to the problems that older adults face?
We have an infrastructure to promote this collaboration. We meet every week for an hour and a half as a division, the basic scientists, the clinicians, the clinical researchers, the educators, and we talk about our challenges.
You can do research. You don't need to be in an academic medical center, but being in one creates a more highly defined research question and tempers your investigations to the realities of need.
I see my patients, I know what they are going through, I know what diseases and what syndromes they are suffering from. I see the whole picture. It helps me also to focus my research question, helps me to think more carefully about designing the intervention, about treatments.
I think as a fellow, the role of research here is unique because you get to work with world-renowned researchers who go internationally to talk about their geriatrics research, and yet they all are so invested in their trainees that, you know, our mentors are always very hands-on. They're always able to answer questions if we have them. And so I think that's something that you don't find in other places a lot. And I also feel like they do a lot of what I'm interested in is more of the translation of bench research into bedside care.
We have tried to figure out what the biology is that makes some older people frail and makes them more vulnerable to getting sick and to dying.
So in the biology of healthy aging, we're looking at that syndrome of frailty. What makes an older individual more frail? Through the work of Dr. Jeremy Walston, we have found that one of the cytokines, one of the hormones in the body, is the driving force leading to that frailty phenotype.
Mitochondria are the tiny intracellular components that produce energy. And what we have found over the years is that these mitochondria become more and more dysregulated with aging.
And we think now there are ways to modulate it with aging where you improve that energy production in aging individuals.
Understanding that biology within the next decade or maybe two, that we will be much better able to intervene in a way that allows us to maintain some of that youthful resilience that we all have, even into very old age.
Another example is our hospital at home program. Remember, older people, extremely vulnerable. Hospitals, highly complex, highly technical environments. So the concept we had was, well, why don't we take the hospital out of the loop?
The two times I've been here, the main problem is the ear.
So by providing ongoing longitudinal care in the home, you can really provide much better care at much lower costs.
Slowly but surely, people are catching on that understanding people in their own environments, in the home visit, is one of the best ways to really get to know that patient as a person. And knowing that patient as a person is one of the most important ways of providing medical care for her or for him.
In geriatric medicine, we're caring for the frailest and those with multiple active medical conditions, and we manage them long term. So it isn't a day or two of managing a bronchitis or a week or two managing a pneumonia. We're managing things like congestive heart failure that will be lifelong. It's very rewarding for us and very meaningful and important to the older adults we serve.
I am now getting emails and calls literally on a daily basis. You know, we're interested in this model, can we talk about it? We're interested in adopting this model, will you help us?
We've created a curriculum and published it so that other training institutions can do this same kind of thing if they want to.
And clearly it's going to be much cheaper for us as a society to take care of them at home rather than to wait until they get so sick that they come to the emergency room and they're admitted. So the model of physician house call that we've had on the Hopkins Bayview campus for 40 years really will be informing the way healthcare will work in the United States going forward. We're not recreating an old-fashioned model. We're showing the way forward.
Ultimately, patients need to be part of the healthcare team, and they need to understand their illnesses.
About 15 years ago, we came up with this simple notion to utilize interactive patient education to deliver them a tailored information in an effective way, which is guided by adult learning theories.
So they're sitting in a hospital bed. They've got a tablet device similar to an iPad where they're not only reading about their illnesses, but being quizzed on it. It allows people who have often very low health literacy to get educated about diseases and medications that are important for them to know about.
Another important objective is that healthcare is complicated for older people, especially people that have the eligibility needs that our population does. So they utilize a lot of healthcare. So a lot of what we do is designed to preserve autonomy for the older adult, but also to control healthcare utilization, help keep healthcare costs down. So the PACE program gets involved and tries to support those individuals so that they can meet that personal goal of staying at home.
The Shapiro Center was founded about a year ago to help improve the care of older adults through education. So at our very core, we're really about making the experience for older people and their families better in the healthcare system, but using the method of educating the people who take care of them.
It's been a dream of mine and a dream of many of our faculty to be able to develop curricula and programs that would actually translate what we've learned into physicians' practices. If you go out right now on the web and try to find a foundation or a government entity that would fund that kind of research, you might be able to cobble together some of it, but you wouldn't be able to cover it all. Through the generosity of grateful patients and families of patients, we've been able to put together a program like our Shapiro Geriatric Medical Education Center.
I don't think American medicine and American geriatric medicine would be anywhere near the level it is now without philanthropy. It's the ability to think outside the box. It allows you to do something that's not traditional.
Philanthropic gifts are critical to our scientific mission. Oftentimes, new ideas are very difficult to fund through normal NIH mechanisms. So some of the gifts that we've received over the years have really allowed us to begin doing research that otherwise wouldn't have been done.
Mason Lord is the real giant whose shoulders we stand on. Though he died at age 39, I think his impact was powerful.
He really forecast the American medical scene in a very prescient way that's remarkable to me. It must have been his two primary values were respecting the dignity of the individual as a patient and in those that were quite disabled and incapable taking care of themselves and empowering them. And I believe that was unique, at least a unique perspective at a time when disabled individuals were sometimes institutionalized.
Mason Lord is a mentor to me that I've never personally met, but he's been valued on this campus as a leader in society. A leader is first a person and a doctor second. And he valued the care and help of the most vulnerable of Baltimoreans. And that's what we do every day here.
Mason Lord began to envision a different future, and we're very proud of how we've built upon that legacy.
What I get most excited about is seeing that research portfolio sort of take off and other people pick it up, the junior investigators, other investigators from around the country and around the world, and having them sort of take some of our ideas and studies and really expand on them and make a big difference in the lives of older adults.
That's the most exciting thing to me right now, because I think that's where we can make a really big difference, where just affecting the dozen people that come through our primary care training every year, well, they go out and work in a practice and influence the way that practice functions, or they go out to another academic center and say, hey, why don't you guys do it this way? So that's that kind of dissemination through practice.
It's about trying to do things better, trying to do things in an exemplary way, trying to take care of a population that have enormous needs in a way that we'd want to be taken care of, or our parents would want to be taken care of. And you got to just start baby steps at a time and do the right thing. And if you have an institution that's behind you and nurturing you and supporting you, it's possible.